Welcome to another episode of Lifetime Talks. I'm David Freeman.
And I'm Jamie Martin.
And we're going to be talking about omega-3s today, and we got Paul Kriegler. We're going to give a little background on Paul. He's a registered dietitian and personal trainer who has worked for Lifetime for over 13 years. Serves as a director of nutritional products at Lifetime and consults on a number of other scientific and health-related topics, all at Lifetime. So he's a runner as well? Yeah? What have you done? Several marathons and 3 Ironman triathlons. Can we say beast mode over here?
Beast mode.
Yes. Welcome, Paul. Welcome. How you doing?
It's good to be here, David. Yeah. Doing well.
Glad to have you back. So omega-3s, that's what we're going to be talking about today. Let's dive right in.
Sure. What do you want to know?
All about them. I mean, most people probably say there's different forms. You got omega-3, omega-6. Like, when we actually think about the purpose of omegas, what are they?
Omega-3s are a class of polyunsaturated fats. Omega-6 are another class of polyunsaturated fats. And that just describes their chemical structure. Mm-hmm. We don't have to get into the chemistry of it necessarily, but omega-3s have their first double bond on the third carbon of the chain. That's why they're called omega-3s. And there's 4 different types of omega-3s. I don't know if you want me to expand on those 4 types of omega-3s right now.
I don't know them, but yeah, but go for it.
Sure. We talk about them a lot, or people hear about them a lot, because they're an essential nutrient, which means the body can't really make them in sufficient quantities to maintain its normal health or optimal health. So we have to consume them in our diet or from supplements.
Okay.
So that's what makes them an essential nutrient, is the body can't keep up with the demand.
Gotcha. So even though there are 4 different types, can you just name them for us? So if somebody's looking at a label and they want to know what omega-3s are that they should be looking for.
Sure. There's one that comes from plants. It's ALA, or alpha-linoleic acid, and that's actually the one that's essential.
Okay.
The body cannot make that one. However, the body can take that from the diet or supplements and convert it to other forms of omega-3s, which are eicosapentaenoic acid and docosapentaenoic acid. And another one that's called DPA omega-3, which is less important. But EPA and DHA, so the second and third ones I mentioned, are of primary importance to all of our cell membranes and red blood cell health and basically all the tissues in our body, including our skin, our eyes, digestive system, heart muscle. They're essential for the health of all of our cell membranes.
Right. So what happens if we are deficient in omega-3s?
Well, everything gets worse. Everything.
Yep.
So our ability to combat or handle inflammation or resolve inflammation, because inflammation is a natural process. It's actually a really healthy process when it's conducted properly by the body. Everything gets worse when we're deficient in omega-3s. Cell signaling, so hormones telling a cell to do something that a cell is supposed to do, can't happen normally. Cell membrane function, meaning letting nutrients and other signaling molecules in or out of a cell, can't happen normally. So in short, if you're deficient in omega-3s, lots of things get worse in our physiology.
You often hear about it, too, as essential for brain health. Can you speak to its role in cognitive health?
Yeah. So omega-3s in cognitive health have to do with a couple different mechanisms. One is just the structure of the neurons that our brain is made of and our nervous system is made of. They're pretty delicate cells, and they're susceptible to damage, whether that's physical damage or oxidative stress, so like metabolic damage.
Yep.
And they're constantly going through repair, right? So they're constantly regrowing or repairing as they encounter damage, because that's what we do as humans. We just encounter damage everywhere. But omega-3s have roles in maintaining the structural integrity of neurons, as well as roles helping regulate the messages passing between neurons. And should something bad happen to that tissue, whether it's like a concussion or metabolic stress, like a sudden drop in blood sugar or an incredible burst of oxidative stress from a super tough workout, or from a toxin that the body's trying to react to, omega-3s are involved in resolving that inflammation. So bringing homeostasis back to that tissue or that system. So that's why they're important for brain health and cognitive health.
I would say, like, a lot of listeners right now, they want to consume the information and want to go apply it right away. Mm-hmm. So instead of just going out and getting any kind of this omega-3 because it's labeled as omega-3, all omega-3s are not created equally. What makes the difference of the actual benefits of what makes it the best omega-3 for you? Is it tested? Like, what? How do you know, and how would you be able to determine what's going to be the best one for you to take?
Yeah, are we talking supplements specifically? Mm-hmm. The best, the most reliable source, the most economical source, and most consistent source for most people is to take a fish oil supplement.
Okay.
Certain species of fish are extremely rich in EPA and DHA,
right,
omega-3 oils. And there's well-established processes for responsibly sourcing some of those species. For example, Lifetime uses exclusively anchovy. So it comes from South Pacific, right off the coast of Peru. The fishery is really well managed from a sustainable sense. It's a very small species of fish, so a short life cycle, which means they don't have a lot of time out in the wild to accumulate, bioaccumulate toxins from their environment, which is, you know, contrast that with larger species of fish like tuna.
Right.
They're predatory fish. They're eating other animals, and they're accumulating all those other animals' toxins as they mature. So look for small species of fish. Mm-hmm. And pro tip, if the product doesn't specify the species, it's a big red flag. Mm-hmm. It means that they're just getting crude, general, marine omega-3 oil, and you don't know what it's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
Which just raises a lot of red flags. And then the fish oil itself, when it's in supplement form, it should be very, very transparent.
Okay.
It shouldn't be cloudy. It shouldn't smell bad.
Right.
Those are all red flags that the fish oil hasn't been properly concentrated, deodorized, stabilized, and encapsulated. So those are a few things to look out for.
I was going to double down on that as far as the EPA, DHA as well, as far as combined. I know you mentioned it. Does a amount of milligrams matter in this case as far as when you are starting to invest into that product? And if so, why?
Sure. For general purposes, not as much.
Okay.
The body can kind of convert some EPA to DHA if it needs more DHA and vice versa. So there are some instances where you might want to look for a higher EPA fraction in the fish oil versus a DHA, and there's also some instances where DHA is the bigger priority.
Okay.
DHA tends to be more beneficial for maturing nervous systems. So think pregnancy, infancy, young childhood, whereas EPA has shown to be more beneficial for like later stage diseases, like specifically lowering risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So throughout the life cycle, can we split hairs and maybe build a case for higher DHA or higher EPA? Sure. But, you know, when push comes to shove, you just need your total omega-3s to be high enough or adequate enough.
Right. So we've talked about supplements, but I also want to talk about food sources, because you can get, you know, omegas from food. So let's talk about those. What are some good sources of omega-3s that we want to get more of in our diets?
Sure. Some of the plant sources that people are familiar with are walnuts, flax seeds, chia seeds. Those supply ALA, so alpha-linolenic acid. However, humans are notoriously bad at converting ALA to the more useful EPA and DHA forms. Yep. That conversion happens at less than 5%.
Ooh.
So if you ask me, you're kind of wasting your time trying to get all of your omega-3s from plant sources.
Right.
Animal sources supply direct sources of EPA and DHA. The best sources for that are fish, so sardines, anchovies, mackerel, so cold water fish species. Wild salmon is a good source as well. Again, short life cycle, even though it's a larger fish. And then some other, you know, fish like tuna, those can be sometimes meaningful sources as well.
Okay. If does everybody need omega-3s? I mean, I should rephrase that, because it feels like, are most of us deficient in omega-3s and it would be benefit from taking them?
Yeah.
Like you said, because they're essential.
Yeah, I think so. You know, my litmus test is asking people if they regularly consume one of those healthy fish sources,
right,
you know, the top omega-3 sources, at least 3 times a week. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking about like a 2-ounce portion. I'm talking like 8 to 10 ounce portion three times a week. And if they're not getting that, I would be surprised if their blood or tissue levels of omega-3s came back in the optimal range.
Mm. That's kind of a lot of fish, mm-hmm, to be eating each week.
It's expensive.
Yeah, I know. So it's probably, in some cases, supplementing is the way to go, because it's probably a little bit more cost effective as well.
Yeah, it's very economical. It's very reliable. Mm-hmm. And again, there's really good methods for purifying and stabilizing those oils. So I think it makes a lot of sense for people to include omega-3 mm-hmm supplements into their routine.
Right.
So being a parent, I just want to go to the children now, as far as how we can start to incorporate that. If they don't like to eat fish or whatever it may be, is there supplementation? Is that something that can be added to their regimen as well? Mm-hmm. And if so, because I'm assuming most kids probably don't want to take fish oil pills, right? So like what would be a substitution there if you would have any hacks in that space?
Yeah, I mean, of course, you want to check with the pediatrician and, mm-hmm, and make sure you're clearing all those choices through them. But liquids are a good option.
Okay.
Liquid fish oil. You can get a highly concentrated liquid fish oil. For example, we carry one from Thorn on our website. Mm-hmm. It tastes like raspberry lemonade.
Hmm.
You know, you really can't tell that it's fish oil.
Like, oh, yeah.
I mean, it's oily.
Right.
But a teaspoon a day is like an adult dose.
Wow.
So pair that back a little bit for a kid, and it's an easy way to get omega-3s into their system.
Awesome.
One other question before we wrap this up is, I know, David, you are vegan, mm-hmm, and so you're not eating, you know, any mm-hmm animals or any animal products, right? So what about for the anybody who's avoiding, you know, meats or anything like that? How can they make sure? Because you said ALA is hard to mm-hmm to convert in the body. Mm-hmm. What should those folks do or think about?
They should think about prioritizing some of the plant sources of omega-3s. Mm-hmm. So get what they can out of the plant sources, and then consider an algal oil.
Mm.
So there's a vegan-friendly version of omega-3s that it's a marine source, but mm-hmm it's not technically an animal, so it's from algae. There's more and more reliable supply chains producing high-quality, more concentrated algal mm-hmm oils. It's something that we're looking into at Lifetime as far as bringing in a new product as well.
Mm-hmm.
But to this date, it's been challenging to establish a solid supply chain in that area.
Mm, interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any other questions?
No, I think he took us for a little ride there with the fish oil. I appreciate that.
Paul, anything else you want to add?
I don't think so.
All right. There you go. That's omega-3s. Thanks for coming back, Paul.
Thanks,
awesome.
Paul.
Thanks for having me.